Hello, you're with India Post Live. India Post Live is, of course, India's first online news conversation web TV. I'm Ishan Russell, and you too can participate in this conversation. Of course, India Post Live is your website. It's about you and your views and what you want to talk about. And so you can join in the conversation. Just go to indiapostlive.com and log in and post your comments over there. Or you can use Twitter, hashtag India Post Live, or use our Twitter handle at India Post Live to join in this conversation. And while you're on our website, indiapostlive.com, there's a very exciting game, a rather cool game that you can go and play with the election fever obviously on. What you can do is go and check out the vote race, which in which you can play as Arvind Kejriwal or Narendra Modi or Rahul Gandhi, and you can you have to go collect as many votes as possible. So pick your favorite leader and try to get as many votes for him as possible. Go play that game. It's a great game to play. But today, on a more serious note, we're talking about our neighborhood, and we're talking about elections. How is that linked, we wonder? Because there's no elections that are happening anytime soon in Pakistan or in other neighboring countries. Well, elections over here are having an impact over there. How is that so? Well, the Aam Aadmi Party, of course, is a phenomenon that we've seen in India over the past one and a half years especially. And that seems to have spilled over across the border to Pakistan, where a few individuals have found some inspiration. And in fact, we'll put that on your screens right now. The Aam Aadmi, they're called the Pakistan Aam Aadmi Party. Now, this is at a very minuscule level right now. It's not really that big, but it does point us to the fact that the sentiment, the popular sentiment behind such a movement, an anti-corruption movement or a popular movement of the people, is something that the Aam Aadmi Party represents in India and therefore is being sought by many individuals in Pakistan. To discuss all this and more, we'll have a lot of voices coming in from Pakistan. And in our studio today, of course, is Mr. Mubarak Haider. He's a columnist, a thinker, writer, commentator, founding member of the Pakistan People's Party, and has been in India and writing about Pakistan, has written many seminal works as far as pro-democracy, I would rather say.
Anti-dogma
and pro-democracy books.
Anti-fundamentalist.
So, sir, we talk about the Pakistan Aam Aadmi Party. I mean, how real are they? How serious are they?
Seriousness, of course, is undoubted. Everybody who thinks of ameliorating human situation in any country is a serious person. Pakistan needs the serious effort to eradicate corruption, to bring some prosperity or hope to the common man. These are issues for which, you know, in history, Pakistan's history, the greatest movement was Zulfikar Ali Bhutto's movement, which was, and of course in the East Pakistan, which is now Bangladesh, there was that great Mujibur Rahman's movement. These were great mass movements, which showed that the people of Pakistan do need material benefits and material rights, human rights and material prosperity rights. But you know, the movements were crushed by certain forces, which you know and I know, in Pakistan have become very powerful. For example, the interference of GHQ in Pakistan's politics has been a world notorious, well-known reality. That was against the first great movement, that is People's Party's movement. Ziaul Haq took over and implemented his very strong fundamentalist Islamic agenda. That has been continuing. And any party which tries to address the common man's problems has to face the fundamentalist forces of religion and army and the feudals. That is a problem which every party which tries to bring some hope to the people has to face. So that is again the case with new parties which are trying to come in.
Are there any other parties like
there is not only this Aam Aadmi Party, which is mainly in Karachi. Some activity they have done is basically in Karachi. In Lahore, it has not been visible. But then there is another party which they call themselves the Liberal Party of Pakistan or Pakistan Liberal Party. That is led by some gentleman who is in Iceland. Mm-hmm. And that is mainly on Facebook. This party, the Aam Aadmi Party, which took inspiration from your Indian political situation, has not yet become any strong reality, but they are known in Pakistan as a possibility. But you know, the main thing is very important to note is that Imran Khan, who came with the famous agenda of anti-corruption, and he gave us a promise in Pakistan, a manifesto in which he said, 90 days, I need 90 days in power to eradicate corruption from Pakistan. When he came in power in the frontier province, which is now Pakhtunkhwa, he could not do it in almost a year is now there, and not a single department has shown any signs of redemption. That is one very weak point in Pakistani politics, that people who come with a promise are exposed very soon as untrue, non-serious, non-practicable. And therefore, the next that comes with a real, maybe a very honest motive, the next party that comes with more honest motives is handicapped because of a certain bad experience of the people about an existing party. Yeah, this is one big tragedy that we will face if new party, for example, this Randhawa's party or from Iceland, a party comes and they start doing the same, trying to implement the same program that Imran Khan promised.
Right.
They will have a cold attitude from the people who have already been betrayed. Not once, but many times.
Perhaps a sense of betrayal is something that has not really made this movement almost like a wildfire. Amar Mughal joins us from Karachi. He's a political commentator. Thanks very much for coming in, Amar. It's a pleasure to have you on the show. What do you make of the Pakistan Aam Aadmi Party? And let's talk in context. I mean, I know they're not a big force to reckon with right now. But let's talk in context of perhaps popular support that such a message could have.
Thank you for inviting me. Partially, I agree with Mr. Iqbal, Mr. Mubarak Haider, but there is no such thing as Aam Aadmi in Pakistan. From the very start, the liberal parties, secular parties, leftist parties were crushed for the sake of fighting Cold War at the behest of America. And later, the Zulfikar Ali Bhutto element, who introduced the cheap slogan of Roti, Kapda and Makan, but mainly his party was consist upon feudal lords. Even now, Imran Khan talks of Aam Aadmi, middle class, this and that, but his own party consists upon feudal lords, tribal chiefs, industrialists. There's no such thing as Aam Aadmi in Pakistan.
Would you concur with that?
No. What he's saying is basically correct criticism of the parties. I think he is not trying to say that there is no common man in Pakistan. Of course, there are common people in Pakistan, crores of them, hundreds of thousands of them are starving. They are in a very bad shape. There are suicides among poor people. And that is not something that he is disputing. He is perhaps disputing that the parties that come in politics and talk about Aam Aadmi do not have members who can call themselves Aam Aadmi. They have almost every
so
time...
They're resorting to pretty traditional politics. See, what we've seen with the Arvind Kejriwal model over here, the model of politics that was adopted of the door-to-door campaigning or just making anybody a minister, not going in for the... I mean, later in the Lok Sabha polls, then it also followed much the same lines. But initially, that was the thing, that anybody could rise to that seat of power. Do you think that kind of a movement could find popular support there, Amir?
No way. It will take time. It will take education. It will take literacy. it will take time, both in Pakistan and India, to break the stronghold of political families, feudal families, peers, shrine keepers, and religious leaders.
You have to work hard.
That's true about Pakistan and maybe partially true about India, but I believe the main problem that you do not face and we do face is the critically important hold of the three elements in Pakistan, that is the feudals, as he is correctly pointing out, the feudals, and the religious, professional religious groups, parties and groups, who have madrasas, who have, you can talk about peers also. This is, you can call it, the category is the religious, professional religious exploiters of religion. Okay, then the third is the very important power, which is your Pakistan's armed forces, the generals, as you call them, because armed forces are from common people, but the generals or the GHQ or the ISI, they have outgrown their role, overgrown into an institution in themselves. Yesterday, some very good remark came from a friend of mine, Hussein Naqi, a very senior journalist and a brilliant leftist. He pointed out a beautiful aspect of the whole thing. He said, when ISI and army talk about being an institution, how do they justify their claim? They are a department of the government. How do they call themselves an institution? An institution or a idara, they call them idara. Idara means something that is not under government. It's an independent human entity which plays politics or does intellectual activity, but has nothing to do with salaried groups. Army is a department, but the army has grown into a political force in Pakistan. And therefore, these three major players in politics will not allow any real movement, because even force is being used, you know. When there is a physical force used against a political entity, then politics becomes even more hard, even more difficult to pursue. Maybe in India you don't have this kind of manhandling. For example, a political party starts coming up, like Anna Hazare's movement came. And we closely observed your activity here. It was a very promising aspect of Indian politics, that people could come out in millions and they could demand something, and nobody could beat them or give them physical manhandling or kill anybody. But in Pakistan, if there is target killing, if I start a movement and I just say, let me be very clear, and he will maybe bear me out. If I stand up in a group of 10 people, just a group of 10 people, and I say, Islam is not relevant, we have to talk about problems, Islam should be relegated to individual activity of a Muslim, I can be immediately beaten physically by those 10 people who stand with me and talking to me. They can get worked up, and they can start shouting at me, and they can tell me to leave Pakistan because it is a country for Islam, and you, how do you dare say something about Islam like this? So the blackmail, the physical torture, the physical assault, and the intimidation, these are issues which obstruct a common man's activity in Pakistan. You cannot go and hope that a common man from, say, a poor fellow doing, for example, driving a rickshaw, auto rickshaw, can hope to get votes and become even a BD member, as you call the local body member, because he will immediately face the local important man, whosoever is important and powerful in the locality. he will physically handle him and stop him. This is not so in India, as I understand.
All right, so there's a lot of self-censorship, Amir, that one has to understand.
Every word of Dr. Mubarak Haider.
Beg pardon?
I agree with each and every word of Dr. Mubarak Haider. He is correct.
All right, but as far as the experience of people goes, see, something like a corruption issue would find a lot of resonance across, I mean, across socioeconomic boundaries, across every kind of boundary. An issue like corruption, which the Aam Aadmi Party was very able to capitalize in India, can that? I mean, you mentioned about the Tehreek-e-Insaf and Imran Khan saying that 90 days and review of corruption.
There is a media campaign with malified intent to malign politician, and for this corruption mantra has been used since years in Pakistan and both India as well. No doubt there is corruption, but not as much as it is being exploited by the media.
All right, see, but wouldn't that be shooting the messenger instead of, I mean, ultimately you and I both know that corruption is there in India and corruption is there in Pakistan. So do you think for the people because I think in India it came to such a point where people just said, enough is enough. Do you think Pakistan is on the cusp of such a spontaneous revolution? I remember covering the Anna Hazare movement and I termed it a spontaneous revolution because there were suddenly in a day there were 100 people over there.
I will prefer gradual change would be better. Gradual change, not revolution, not bloody revolution, not anarchy, gradual change. It will come, but gradually.
Yeah, that's right. You know, it's not only that theoretically you and I agree revolutions are only destructive.
No, they're not violent. I mean,
they are
positive.
Destructive.
Yeah.
Well, not only that, but also the practically impossible, the practical impossibility of a revolution. It is that we have to rule out. But if we mean immediate or fast-moving, fast-moving activity in politics, that I think is not only not possible, but not advisable in Pakistan, because in Pakistan, democracy has received a chance only recently. It is the first legal constitutional government handing over the charge to the next elected government, first time. Mm-hmm. This reality has to be cemented and given a solid basis to become an institution, to become a tradition in itself, so that after some time, and that is what I am saying, we are 60 years behind you. Simple. You have a 60 years supremacy over us in democracy. That is, you have been consistent. We have not been in democracy. It is very fresh in Pakistan. If anybody in Pakistan starts creating a new party and criticizes the existing parties, it is only to damage their credibility. You know, that is exactly what the three forces I pointed out would love to have in Pakistan. That is, the existing political parties be discredited, and they must be rejected by the people, whereas the new will not emerge. So that will only strengthen the demand which has become almost instinctive with Pakistan, that there should be army takeover. This has become instinctive.
And I believe it has a lot of popular support also. Often,
yes, right? It has. This demand has become instinctive. For the last 60 years, we have known so much of martial law that any political issue, any political party that comes in power or comes in public has the possibility of being just eradicated by contempt, by a negative propaganda. So easy to completely discredit a political movement from the very start. For example, Randhawa or me or anybody starts a small party, mm-hmm. immediately, as soon as they see that the party can have some effect, they will start a propaganda that what they call nip the evil in the bud. Mm-hmm. That is, why should you allow a political movement to emerge? Because we saw that Mujibur Rahman became a power, that Bhutto became a power, and they challenged the army and the feudals, the religious forces. So, and then this man, Altaf Hussain, came up. And therefore, it is very dangerous to allow a movement to become effective. Therefore, ISI, and I don't fear to be on record, ISI promoted Imran Khan to become a political force so that genuine political forces do not come into power.
Right?
So, and they sent feudals to join Imran Khan when they started making it a real party 2 years ago. They sent the Mahmood Qureshi and Makhdoom, that man from people from Nawaz League,
PML,
mm-hmm. from PML, the many people left PML and went to join Imran Khan and gave it gave the party the credibility that it's a powerful party. Mm-hmm. And many people from frontier, the Taliban-backed people, were sent to attend his huge public meetings, one or two, which made him a possible future of Pakistan's politics. That is a plan to keep politics within the fold of those powerful
so
classes.
It still remains an oligarchy.
Same remains. It is therefore my, I'm not a pessimist, I have been known as an incorrigible optimist, but there has to be some realism.
Yeah.
I believe that political party for the people, a real political party, has to be a secular party in Pakistan. It, as soon as it makes a compromise with religious forces or with the feudals or with the army, it is no more a people's party. It is no more the party of the common man. A party of the common man has the biggest obstruction as soon as it really addresses the main issue, that is secularism. That is, we are not going to be party to any one religion. Mm. That it has to be the modern party has to be people's party.
About a nation rather than a religion.
Yes, everybody from every religion can find redress for their problems.
All right.
That is the main issue. That has to be the main slogan. As soon as that common man's party says this, it commits suicide in Pakistan. How tragic. The main issue that has to be taken cannot be taken because it is suicide to take that issue.
So that compromise is always there. But Amir, I want to talk to you about the cynicism in the common man in Pakistan. I mean, how cynical has he become of politics, of the political establishment?
Due to long periods of martial laws and subversion of press during Cold War, the whole society is destroyed in Pakistan. Civil society is destroyed in Pakistan. No left-wing, secular-wing, alternative thinking exists in Pakistan.
That's
we
right.
are still living in a Cold War era. They have to, state have to alter their thinking.
So popular, forget the Aam Aadmi Party, but something like the Arab uprising, which you saw, the Spring Revolution that we saw across the world. Is there any kind of cynicism that could create such popular movements, or do you think the society is too changed?
Pakistan, it is not possible in Pakistan because Pakistan is divided on racial, ethnic, sectarian, and religious lines. Communities, on the basis of communities, biradaris, caste, language, sects. Not possible. Arab Spring, basically, Arab speak single language. Pakistan, we have 5, 6, 7 languages in Pakistan. 72 sects exist in Pakistan. 72 sects in Islam exist in Pakistan. They are not even agree on the way of prayers.
All right. So indeed, a lot of
let me add.
All right, but let me just thank Amit, because we need to let him go and get another colleague of yours from Pakistan in. Amit, thank you very much for coming in. Any final comments that you'd like to make?
Just a friendly advice to Pakistanis and Indian: make peace, no war.
All right, that certainly, I think, would be endorsed by everybody on that rather good note. Thanks very much, Amit. It was a pleasure
to
have you on this show.
Oh,
and we hope
so
to
nice
have you in future conversations as well. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
But, I mean, it's rather disheartening, isn't it? The cynicism that prevails, that there is no civil society, that there... I mean, it's been systematically weeded out of the system. That does it feature in terms of education? Does alternate thinking, does any format of that exist? I mean, what I have heard from friends, and I have friends in Pakistan, and the problem is that most of them are in London, most of them are elsewhere. That middle class or anybody who has any means is stepping out of Pakistan, and nobody's taking really responsibility for their own country. Is that a cynicism that perhaps pervades the youth of the country?
Yes, it has. It has existed, and I'm afraid it has grown deeper. Mm-hmm. The new generation in Pakistan, unfortunately, do not understand the political problems of Pakistan even as much as the earlier generations did. And the earlier generations did not understand the political issues at all. And the new generation does not even understand that much. Mm-hmm. The problem is the new people are now, those who supported Imran Khan, for example, they do not understand that there is a very small example can show you the malady, the problem. Our young people do not even know that there are any countries in the world which have better systems than Saudi Arabia. They believe India has no system. India are anti-Pakistan, anti-Islam forces. There are, the whole world is anti-Islam. And Islam has to grow into a powerful reality and conquer the world. This is your young man who supports Imran Khan. This is his thinking. He believes Islam has to dominate the world. These are problems which were created deliberately by forces, that the three forces that we repeatedly talk about. They were very conscious manipulators. They created this division and this deep chaos among people's thinking to perpetually remain in power, because when the whole nation is divided and has no opinion, no understanding of things or problems, then the most organized will hold ground. The most organized are therefore holding ground, and the people of Pakistan are deeply divided. That deeply, as he rightly pointed out, there are the horizontal and vertical divisions in Pakistan's populace, and these are not coming to any end.
Right.
There is no, we don't see the promise, because there is no movement towards unity or towards realization of issues. Only hope that we now have is it's a joke to say, but it's the only reality. On Facebook and Twitter, the international media, as we call it, because Pakistan media is not doing anything for the education of Pakistani people, but these are the forums, for example, Facebook, Twitter, and international newspapers, which are supporting us in a way to create a group of people, to create an opinion which can, in the days to come, become a force.
All right.
I personally, I will not disclose the details, but I personally know almost hundreds of thousands of young men, and not only young men, I mean
young people.
People of Pakistan, hundreds of thousands, who agree that a new political movement is required, and this movement has to be a very kind, very respectful political force which does not attack religion, mm-hmm. which does not negate religion as something evil. It has to respect religion, mm-hmm. but it has to be independent of religion.
Right.
That organization will emerge in the next few years, but at the moment it is only a kind of nascent movement,
right.
movement of ideas. There are many people. We can hope that in the days to come they will become political force,
right.
but not immediately.
All right. So, but we have more young people coming in from Pakistan. There's a very familiar TV face for any Pakistani viewers joining us. Ajmal Jani is joining us from Lahore. Hi, Ajmal. How are you? Ajmal, of course, is a well-known journalist in Pakistan. And Ajmal, I'll just start off with a straight question to you. I mean, we've been talking about a whole lot of cynicism that is prevalent across the youth of Pakistan about the political system, but that resentment or that cynicism is not being capitalized by the politicians, and there is no political force. I mean, even the Pakistan Aam Aadmi Party is a relatively non-starter. It's not even a non-starter. It's a few people on Facebook till now. But where does this go? Is there popular cynicism that could create a future movement?
Well, thank you very much, Shiv Raj. If I'm not wrong in pronunciation of your name, salam and namaste to all the viewers on the other side of the border. Thank you very much for asking me and for inviting me yet again. This is a very interesting topic, by the way. I mean, we are discussing the hardcore political issues here and there, but this very issue is very interesting and that needs to be addressed. First of all, let me correct you on a couple of things. I saw Subhash Rai's tweet on today's session, and he wrote PAAP, Pakistan Aam Aadmi Party. Well, it's not PAAP at all. Mm-hmm. It's purely PAAP, AAP, Aam Aadmi Party Pakistan. So in Hindi, you know what does PAAP mean.
Yeah.
It's not a PAAP. And secondly, Aam Aadmi Party, they're in Pakistan, they're in India.
Mm-hmm.
But that has significantly able to register itself and won the elections, and they were into the power in Delhi. But unfortunately, they were unable to click it out. But here in Pakistan, the thing you were discussing a while ago with your honorable guest, I'm missing his name. I'm sorry, I was
Mubarak
on
Khedar.
The show today. All right, thank you, sir. I think had they been, or Aam Aadmi Party in Pakistan, had they been there in the political scenario well before the elections, that have added some crisp in the political scenario. But I mean, Adnan Randhawa, the founder of Aam Aadmi Party Pakistan, I know this man is former diplomat and practicing lawyer. He used to write in newspapers as well. And he is the founder of the AAP. He's not a well-known figure, and certainly an Aam Aadmi Party's founder should be among their men. So, significantly, they are unable to make any impact on any level. Within the journalists or the media, press, or anywhere. I mean, in any layer, they are unable to mark their any kind of impact.
Ajmal, just to stop you, interrupt you, I would differ on you from you on this point a little bit, because somebody like an Arvind Kejriwal also, I'm not the biggest fan of his, but he was also relatively a non-starter. He was on the fringes only, but he caught on to an issue that was really popular, and that somehow, that automatically got him the support that he needed for his political movement. So I'm not getting into his political movement, but just the popular support that is there.
Arvind Kejriwal, before election, before being into the government, he made 3 promises, if I'm not wrong, 3 to 4 promises.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was into the power, he started working on those promises immediately. Here, the case is different. I mean, people, Aam Aadmi people here in Pakistan,
mm-hmm.
they were willing, they have tasted this thing, the AAP phenomena. They have tasted it slightly, to some extent, largely. When PTI came into being, and when PTI came into the largest spectrum, they were really following PTI like anything. I myself was the one who covered all the major processions, all the major meetings of PTI in Lahore, in Islamabad, in Peshawar, anywhere in the country. I traveled along with them, I covered their events, and I saw people They were into, you know, countless people were there and all over their gathering. The PTA got that momentum.
Mm-hmm.
And you say about arms, PTA was having that spark. By PTA, I mean Pakistan Tehreek Insaf, being led by Imran Khan. PTA had that spark, and people were really looking for that, first. Secondly, I think here in Pakistan, and maybe in India, or maybe in anywhere in the world, wherever there is democracy, I think there is always a margin of new political force. Sometimes there is a margin for political force that represents layman, aam aadmi. Sometimes there is a margin for some ideological forces. Sometimes it's a margin for some, you know, conservative forces. So here in Pakistan, there was a margin for aam aadmi. And aam aadmi was really looking for PTI.
Hmm.
But, and PTI's leader, Imran Khan, he vowed. He made a lot of promises to the people. He said, yes, we will raise your voice. You are our voice. You are our representative. We will be represented by laymen. But what happened then? I mean, before the elections, when there was a very important stage to distribute tickets for assembly elections, he backed up most of the politicians, those who were part of Pakistan Muslim League Noon, those who were part of Pakistan People's Party, those who were part of Pakistan Muslim League Q, those who were part of the cabinets of dictators.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that has badly shattered his image. That has, you know, that a big reason why PTI was unable to capitalize that momentum which started from the layman. PTI had an ideal chance, had a golden opportunity to, you know, sweep it up, but the promise then Aam Aadmi was not fulfilled, and that's a big reason why they ended up while securing only 30 plus seats in National Assembly. They were only able to form a government in one province, and that is PA. And perhaps that's what which is happening to Aam Aadmi Party in India.
Yes, I would agree
different.
With you on that.
But that is a very different case. One, for instance, let me talk. For instance, I heard about Vishwas Kumar, I think, a very known poet there in India, is the part of Aam Aadmi Party. Vishwas Kumar, if I'm not missing
Kumar
his name.
Vishwas.
Kumar Vishwas, exactly. I mean, when I heard about him, I was delighted. I think I said, that's good, that's good. He's a poet. I mean, he's a well-read, well-educated person. He represents masses. He knows how a layman feels. That's a good relation. But just 2 days ago, I read a statement by Shabana Ilmi, I think. Shazia Ilmi, yeah. I read her statement, and I was shocked. I mean, what the hell she is talking about? And she was trying to clarify her statements.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, damage has been done to Shazia Ilmi's statement. So these kind of things, I mean, okay, fine, you are representing Aam Aadmi Party, but you need to follow certain directions, certain goals. You need to educate your work. You need to educate your members, party members. You need to lay an example by yourself, and you need to focus on your goals. That's the only thing which can make an Aam Aadmi Party successful either here in Pakistan or there in India. But when you take all those, you know, spoiled eggs, bad guys in your ranks, then you are certainly damaging the trust of an Aam Aadmi in you, in your party.
All right, excellent analysis there, Ajmal. I mean, I would completely agree with you on that one. But and it's really true. I mean, at the end of the day, the Aam Aadmi Party, be it in India, be it in Pakistan, be it anywhere else in the world, is about the Aam Aadmi. And ultimately, if the Aam Aadmi himself is corruptible, if he does not want to take a stand and say that I would lead my life in a way that sets an example for others, then, I mean, the politicians also come from us only. Where we are born, of course, that might be dictating how far you rise in your career or something like that. But then it's the, I mean, everybody starts off with a good agenda, don't they? I mean, even in Pakistan, even the worst of dictators that you've had have had some good at their heart, hasn't it? And but that ultimately is up to every individual to go beyond, isn't it?
Yeah, I believe the nations are not made by, I'm sorry if somebody feels insulted, but nations are not made by laymen.
Mm.
Nations are made by thinkers, philosophers, statesmen, men of vision. And the common man gets always, through human history we have seen, the what we call a common man gets only the trickle-down of the civilizational progress that is done by the visionaries of human history. Scientists, thinkers, prophets, leaders, men of great vision, they create a society, and the common man only gets the trickle-down effect, and it's the fruit of civilization that he gets, but it's not his doing. That is where the communist parties are fatally wrong when they start, and Soviet experiment failed because of this. So this is the unfortunate part of human situation, that the common man himself is not capable of doing a wonderful job. He can at best do is to choose between two options, the better one, the more optimistic, the more humanitarian, the more futuristic. And that's all that he can do. And that is also part of the training that we impart to him. That is, again, it is the job of the thinkers and the opinion makers that they arouse the common man to choose one of the better of the two options. Again, he can make serious mistakes in choosing the wrong man or because of a bad education. So again comes the question of education. Again comes the question of the visionary, the leader.
It all seems to be a vicious cycle. I've completely run out of time. I think this is a talk that we need to have more often. Thanks very much, Ajmal, for coming in. I want you to come back in, and we'll talk certainly more about this and any other issues that India and Pakistan can certainly talk about. But it was a pleasure having you on the show. And Heather Saab, I mean, it was a brilliant, brilliant discourse that, I mean, I have come out, learn it from this one. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to have you in our conversation.
Thank you.
All right. Well, that's it in this conversation. But what do you think about the Aam Aadmi Party phenomenon? Do you think this is something that could be replicated in other countries, in Pakistan for that matter? And if you're watching from Pakistan, then do write in to us. Tell us, what do you think about your political system? What could change? What would make it better? Well, all those views you can post on indiapostlive.com, or you can use Twitter, #IndiaPostLive, or use our Twitter handle @IndiaPostLive. Well, on that note, we'll wrap it up. Thanks so much for watching.